सर, आई थिंक वी शुड बी गुड टू गो नाउ। सो आई विल जस्ट फॉर्मली लाइक टू वेलकम एवरीबॉडी टू द 79 AIOC 2021 वर्चुअल कॉन्फ्रेंस। एंड आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर अमित पोरवाल टू प्लीज कम फॉरवर्ड एंड टेक द वर्चुअल डाइस। डॉक्टर अमित पोरवाल।
Thank you. So, welcome you all for the National Symposium on Glaucoma. So, welcome to the National Symposium on Glaucoma in AIC 2021. To begin with, we have our chairpersons. The chairman of the session is Dr. Ramakrishnan, Dr. G. Chandrasekhar. We have the co-chairman, Dr. Ramanjit Siota and Dr. Krishnadas. We have the conveyor, Dr. S.S. Pandav and Dr. B. Shanta. The co-conveyor, Dr. Chandrima Paul and Dr. P. Satyan. And this session will be moderated by Dr. R. Venkatesh and by myself. So each talk will be of 12 minutes, and these are the list of topics. We have six topics, which is shared with all our chairpersons. So without wasting much time, I call upon Dr. Venkatesh sir to please start the session.
Thank you, Amit. This program has been very carefully planned, you know, at least for a couple of days between Amit, myself, and a few other colleagues and seniors. So it's going to be very interesting because we have carefully selected some of the very interesting hot topics, keeping in mind the national symposium and also to attract general ophthalmologists beyond glaucoma specialists. So first, we would like to invite Dr. Sushma to talk about update on structure and function correlation in glaucoma diagnosis. Sushma, please.
Thanks, Dr. Venkatesh. And thanks, Amit and AIOC, for giving me this opportunity. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
You are audible. Perfect. And visible.
Okay. So, a very good evening. I'm going to talk about update on structure and function in glaucoma diagnosis. Well, whether structure or function has always been an everlasting debate, whether structure can detect early or function can detect early. But we know that in many of our studies, like EMGT or OHTS, we've had this issue that only 10% of the or very less percentage of patients we use both, or can both structure and function can actually detect the progression. So this is in OHTS also, you can see only 10%. And this is a study done by Weinrib et al. There also 60% on OCT, 30% on perimetry, and only 10% by both. So, and there has been a convention that structural changes definitely precede functional change. And with more sensitive methods like OCT, we do expect structural change to present first. Now, in a scenario like this, where you see a superior notch and you see a field defect like that, or you see both superior inferior RNFL defects and a field defect like that, it's a perfect situation or correlation. But life is not as black and white. We have zones of gray. We definitely come across not very unusually situations like where you can see a RNFL defect, but normal fields, and you resort to structure techniques like OCT and pick it up and start treating. So in these situations, like OCT helps in predicting or detecting pre-perimetric glaucoma. On the other hand, this is another patient where you can see the nerves being with a peripapillary crescent, and you again see a normal field. And when you do OCT, you see a lot of red zones and actually realize that the nerve size being small, OCT is actually overestimating the damage. So whether to depend on function here or structure here is always a question. In addition to such scenarios, we also do see structure function discordance definitely, because there is a non-linear relationship between structure and function, and agreement depends a lot on the stage of the disease. Like we have early disease where you would see small changes in MD, and advanced glaucoma, we cannot depend much on OCT. And actually, if you look at it, if the methods were to agree perfectly, we would not require both structure and function. We would only have one, and one should suffice. So, but that's not true. So that is why we need to look at both structure and function. I'll be giving an update on structural tests. So I'm not talking much on which is already known. We have HRT, GDX, OCT, and more commonly being used now OCT, which is used for the structural progression or structural documentation at baseline. And we have graduated from time domain to spectral domain to swept source. And as we go higher, we come across faster acquisition speed and advanced algorithms to check or get the data on OCT. However, what we need to remember that diagnostic accuracy of all three OCTs are almost similar when you come to early or pre-perimetric glaucoma, which is the primary role for OCT to pick up. So any of them should be fine. So we have different machines, but largely what we do in each machine is look at the color-coded thickness maps, we look at the deviation maps, we get those parameters which are based on the clock hours, and we look at the statistical comparisons, and we also get the ONH data, which helps us to detect progression or detect the disease at the baseline. Now, we more recently, we have also started looking at ganglion cell complex, which is a nerve fiber layer, ganglion cell layer, and inner plexiform layer. And as we know that most of the RGC synapses in the macula, so scans are largely centered on fovea. Here again, you get thickness map, deviation maps, and significance map. All of us are familiar with these maps in OCT machines, and GCC works more or less similar. So you can see the blue areas or darker areas are where you see the thinning. The black looks shows more thinning. And with the significance maps, you can detect which area is more abnormal. It also gives us a quantitative evaluation in terms of focal loss volume, which can help us detect progression when we are looking at the quantitative progression. More recently, OCTA is something that is being used in glaucoma, where it's a non-invasive imaging technique where RBC motion itself works as a contrast. So that's how you don't have to give a dye and you can still delineate vessels. So what changes in glaucoma that you see is loss of superficial vessel density in the peripapillary area, as you see here on the top figure, and also in the macular region, along with loss of peripapillary choriocapillaries. We are yet to have more standardized things with that, but just to give you a brief that how do you scan OCTA regions? There are optic nerve has three sections like a nerve head slab, a radial peripapillary capillary slab, and a choroid slab. Similarly, in macula, you can have a superficial and deep slab so as to look at the vessels. And this is how actually the normal and a focal defect and a diffuse defect looks like. So if you look at this, there is a NFL defect here. So you can see loss of capillaries here, and you can see an abnormal value in the infrotemporal region. Similarly, in this, where you have a diffuse defect, you can see the loss all around in that heat map and can see all the numbers which are depressed as compared to normal. So this also helps us in quantification of the flow density, which tells us about the vasculature in glaucoma. Just to give you an example of how it can be used in a clinical situation, this is one of the very recent patients I think I saw 2-3 weeks back, came to me with an acute attack of angle closure, and we did a PI, reduced the pressure, and then 1 week later we dilated and did the evaluation. And you can see the right eye, she came with an attack, and there was a significant field damage, whereas the left eye was more or less fine. When you do the OCT, the edema is yet to resolve. The NFL edema is still there, so you cannot pick up much on OCT. Rather, you see more of white zones. But when I did a OCTA, you can see the difference in the density of the vessels in the optic nerve, around the optic nerve head, as well as in the macula, the right eye as compared to the left eye. If you look at the heat maps, it is more clear that you can see the loss of vasculature here. So this is one thing that can be used and has a potential future application. We do see progression softwares on optic nerve head and ganglion cell complexes in terms of looking at the thickness map progressions, RNFL profile changes, and actually thickness progression, which can tell you that at each visit how the numbers are changing. You can actually look at the absolute numbers also even in GCC, so that like this is more clear on this, like how in RNFL also you can see a change from baseline to follow up, so that you can actually quantify the progression and plan your treatment accordingly. Now, so definitely OCT helps in detecting anatomical progression using these softwares. To go further in future, which would be more clear in our future talks, but just to give you a small example of what we did with a OCT machine, we took some 150 odd patients and got the data of those patients using the optic nerve, macula, and disc cube scan. And we had to do a little tweaking of the software to get the raw data from the machine. And when we combined these parameters like Zernike and general extreme value function parameters, we could actually see that the area under the curve improves. So sensitivity of picking up could improve rather than what parameters we could get from the OCT directly. So it definitely has more potential, and we can actually do more with the existing imaging techniques as well. So AI definitely would help making more sensitive parameters with the current technology itself. Getting on to the functional assessment in glaucoma, well, we all know perimetry and we have been using it, so I'm not going to go in detail about the routine perimetry. Even glaucoma progression analysis softwares are very commonly used to detect progression, like in a patient where you check the rate of progression being more and here it is being stable, and that's how we plan our treatments. What is new in functional assessment is a newer program that has come up in Humphrey, that is 24-2C or CETA faster program, where it is almost reduces the test time by 50% as compared to CETA standard. And advantage is that you can get GPA with other strategies. The central correlations do not central locations that are extra in this do not correlate well with the ganglion cell loss, and it is yet to be established as good as 24-2. But what largely makes it faster is all these seven modifications that it uses one case instead of two, and it skips certain things like no second check for blind points, no false positive and false negative catch trials. So there would be some limitations because we are skipping these steps, but still it's a very useful test. And just to explain what points you get extra, if you look at these blue points, they are detected by 24-2 program, and the red points by the 10-2 programs. And the red and green ones are picked up by 24-2 program as well. Now, what you get extra in 24-2C is these 10 points. And these are that have been defined based on the points which are more susceptible to glaucometer's damage. So it gives you a better idea about the central field, especially in early glaucoma when you're looking at. There have been studies to test this algorithm, and it has been shown that it is quite okay in terms of it gives quite identical results as compared to CETA standard, CETA fast, and CETA faster. And even test retest variabilities are more or less within the range. The advantage, as I was telling you, is that the GPA reports can also take CETA fast, so faster. So you can see there's a GPA program taking CETA standard as well as faster. So advantage being that you don't have to re-baseline. Whether that would be really useful in terms of sensitivity point of view is still a question. Well, now looking at the prediction of visual fields from the structural changes, there have been studies earlier as well, where the 24-2 program along with OCT parameters were taken, and these ganglion cell complex and NFL were co-segmented, and they looked at the 54 sectors which correspond to 24-2 program, and a support vector machine was trained independently to predict the field at that point. So if you look at, there was a prediction that was done with the R values of this, and there is possibility of predicting. So to look at the future, if we have structural data and if we can use the AI to enable estimation of visual field from the structural data, you can actually improve the perimetry test by customizing the points that would be given to the patient for checking and actually reduce the test time. So we hope to see so in future, and AI may help us to customize these tests for us further. There are a few slides on virtual reality-based perimeters. They are yet to be time-tested, I would say, so I will not go much in detail looking at the time. One interesting thing is N-goggle, which can check VEP in response to visual stimulation, so more objective assessment of the visual function. However, again, only pilot studies available for that. So the limitations being the variability, so we are yet to... So this is another iPad-based visual field testing. So again, still we are not okay to go ahead with screening or for any clinical use. So this I will skip the combination test that we have. So what I would say is that we have a lot to see in future with the new developments and combinations of structure and functional tests, which may help us predict progression earlier than what we do now. Thank you. Just a last thing to tell you about the what we need to do. Remember, looking at the technology is that we need to understand the technique and its strength and limitation when we are advising a test. It is important to build up the positive predictive value of a test before we advise the same. And to simplify a test, one should not compromise on the diagnostic capability of the test. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sushma. I think it was quite comprehensively covered. I'm sure it's difficult to do it in 12 minutes, but you tried to do the best. And you were telling about AI in different slides in your topic, because AI is a little tricky again when it comes to glaucoma, like glaucoma diagnosis, right? Because optic nerve at OCT, HFA, there's a lot of AI work going on. And right. We have with us an excellent speaker, and also she has done very good work on AI, Dr. Divya Rao, who's going to share her experiences on artificial intelligence and what is the scope in glaucoma and what is the future of AI in glaucoma. Divya?
Just a minute, I'm just sharing my screen. Is it visible?
Audible and visible, Divya.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. Firstly, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the AIOS Scientific Committee, Dr. Amit and Dr. Venkatesh, for giving me an opportunity to speak today in front of a very distinguished audience. My topic for today is potential applications of AI in glaucoma. Here are my disclosures. We live in an era where AI helped predict the coronavirus outbreak even before it happened. So this could be the potential power of AI in glaucoma as well. Before we delve into the topic itself, what is AI? AI is the development of computer programs that model intelligent behavior with minimal human input. Deep learning is a subset of AI that's the latest and most powerful AI tool. It uses a data-driven approach to teach a computer how to solve a task. So given inputs and their desired outputs as examples, the computer learns to solve a task by itself. Here, for example, you have a decentered image and the output could be glaucoma or no glaucoma, and the deep learning model learns to extract the features of glaucoma from this image and classify this image whether it has glaucoma or not. They are also called as convolutional neural networks because they consist of a large collection of mathematical functions arranged in layers that mimic the way neurons work in the brain. Ophthalmology and glaucoma in particular are highly dependent on imaging and make them prime areas for AI application. Glaucoma, as we all know, poses a challenge for all of us when it comes to early diagnosis and determining progression. And deep learning is very well suited for this because it learns to identify subtle features and extract additional features beyond those provided and maximize the network's ability to discriminate between healthy and glaucomatous eyes. So glaucoma, the scope of AI in glaucoma has been evaluated in the context of screening, diagnosis, in detecting progression, as well as in prediction. And fundus images, OCTs, visual fields, as well as a multimodal approach has been evaluated. When we look at deep learning in color fundus photographs, we all know that optic nerve head and RNFL assessment remain the mainstay for clinicians to detect structural change. With advent of portable and inexpensive fundus cameras, especially in low resource or telehealth settings, has made it especially useful in the application of screening. A lot of my work at Remedio has also revolved around the application of AI using color fundus photographs in collaboration with several institutes like Arvind Eye, Narayan Netralaya, as well as Queen's University in Canada. The novel AI algorithm developed actually consists of two components. One is an automated segmentation model that outlines the disc and the cup to give a vertical cup to disc ratio. And the second is a classification model that gives a recommendation for referral or not for those with suspect or likely glaucoma, along with the presence of activation maps. And this entire system has been deployed offline on the edge on a smartphone-based fundus camera, such that you can get a report within 10 seconds without the need of internet or cloud-based inferencing. These are examples of the segmentation model where you can see the automated outline of the disc and cup along with the output of the cup to disc ratio. And here are examples of the class activation maps in the referable glaucoma model. Here we can see classical features like notches with RNFL defects along with increased cup to disc ratio and neuroretinal thinning and beta peripapillary atrophy being highlighted by the model. This shows that the AI was able to identify classical features similar to what clinicians would use in the clinic. The accuracy of this referable model was also tested on independent test sets with very promising results comparable to other global research groups and with a distinct advantage of being deployed offline on a portable a smartphone-based camera. With this, now we are looking at validating this in real-world settings. When we look at deep learning in using OCT images, four main approaches have been tried. One is a glaucoma classification based on measured thickness, thickness maps, and deviation maps with very promising results. However, the main limitation of this approach is that the measured thickness is influenced by RNFL and GCIPL segmentation errors. So in order to overcome this, another approach that has been tried is glaucoma classification from segmentation-free 2D B scans with, again, results which are outperforming the previous approach. The third one which has been tried is a glaucoma classification from segmentation-free 3D OCT volumetric scans with promising results. While this approach was able to utilize all the glaucoma-related information, the training process turned out to be very cumbersome and costly. The fourth approach is a machine-to-machine approach wherein OCT measurements like RNFL thickness, GCIPL thickness, and BMO-MRW measurements were being predicted from fundus photograph. This allowed for objective and quantitative estimates of OCT parameters when OCT is actually not available. Strategies for automated detection from visual fields have also been tried using machine learning classifiers with the use of individual threshold values and clinical indicators like mean deviation and pattern standard deviation. Lee et al. Group used the pattern deviation probability map to distinguish between normal and glaucoma. And Ashoka et al. Went a step ahead where they were even able to distinguish pre-parametric visual fields from healthy eyes. In order to leverage on spatial information within visual fields to detect localized changes, groups have also used this spatial information in machine learning classifiers to result in improved results. Of note is that these models are usually trained with reliable tests and may not be able to identify unreliable exams, commonly encountered in the clinics. Strategies for determining, evaluating progression using AI has also been looked at. And strategies for determining progression include event-based and trend-based analysis. And the current softwares assess progression using global indices, mean deviation and visual field index, visual field indices, or a point-by-point analysis. However, all of these approaches have certain limitations. They can miss subtle changes, assume a constant rate of progression, or typically evaluate progression rates of a single visual field test point independent of adjacent test points, and usually require a large number of visual fields to be able to detect progression. Some of these limitations have been addressed by AI. The group by Wen et al. were actually utilized an unfiltered real world data set of up to 30,000 visual fields to train a deep learning model that was able to predict visual fields up to 5.5 years from a single visual field with good correlation of predicted and actual future visual fields. As you can see here, it currently identified no progression in a neurological field over a 1 year time. And here you can see in the third image where a incomplete superior arcuate scotoma, the AI actually predicted accurate progression and it was comparable to the actual future visual field. However, since only a single visual field was used, a baseline visual field was used in this, was not able to predict when and how soon the progression could occur. So there are groups like Birchick et al. Which used unsupervised learning to improve the estimation rates of progression and prediction of future patterns of visual field loss. Currently, this work that is ongoing where we are looking at AI beyond a single modality to improve accuracy of diagnosis and prediction. For example, an AI that combines the structure and function, a multimodal AI that combines risk factors, clinical exam, and additional tests, and also an AI that looks at the predicting the genetic risk of developing glaucoma. While there are several benefits of utilizing AI, it also comes with a lot of challenges. Some of them being requirement of a large amount of data set, ensuring good diversity in the training data with respect to image quality or ethnicity or representation of disease, using reliable ground truth or reference standards to compare, understanding the black box nature of the model, or generalizing the model beyond the unseen data, validating it in prospective clinical trials, medico-legal and ethical considerations, regulatory hurdles, and even patient and clinician acceptance. While the technical challenges are undeniable, AI could positively impact glaucoma practice, and clinicians need to have an open mind to embrace this technology. In the short term, it can enable cost-effective screening, can be used as a clinical decision support system to reach a diagnosis and help in triage of patients as well. And in the long term, it can help in glaucoma, in identifying glaucoma progression, as well as in AI-based genetic profiling. In conclusion, a successful clinical adoption of robust algorithms will ultimately be achieved if the implementation is safe, evidence-based, and meaningful in improving patient outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Divya. It was an excellent talk, very patiently delivered, a lot of new information delivered. So we'll discuss all these topics at the end of after covering all the topics. So the next talk is by Dr. Rajul Parikh. He will be talking on evidence-based practice for primary angle closure disease.
Thank you, Amit. Thank you, IOC. My slide visible?
Yeah, visible and audible.
So I'll be talking about evidence-based practice for PACD, primary angle closure disease. Now, I'll just give you, this is a very common scenario. Most of the glaucoma specialists see patient refer for second opinion, sometimes progression, sometimes just for second opinion, IOP fluctuating, diagnosed open angle glaucoma. But when you do gonioscopy, you realize that their angle closure, the angle closure glaucoma was missed. And that was a reason for the progression. So it's a very misdiagnosed disease, even in Indian scenario. So I'll be talking about management of primary angle closure suspect, primary angle closure, and primary angle closure glaucoma. Now, if you look, the worldwide, this is Professor Quigley's data, that angle closure is all over the world is significantly less common than open angle glaucoma, but the blindness is more or less similar. So the risk of blindness is 2.5 times more than open angle glaucoma, and that's why it's more dangerous. And if you treat in the early stage, if you basically diagnose in the early stage, right stage, then we can easily prevent the blindness. The risk factor, and again, I'm not going to go in detail, the age, older age, female, Asian, family history, the genetic association is not proven yet. N ocular features, the narrow angle, shallow axial chamber depth, thick lens, short axial length, hyperopia are the risk factor for the angular closure disease. Now, clinical examination, the Von Erich is a good test, but cannot replace gonioscopy. So if you're too busy, and if you have normal IOP and Von Erich more than grade 2, then you can say patient doesn't have angular closure glaucoma most probably, but still I would not say that replace gonioscopy. The gonioscopy, again, I'm sure that during AIOC, during GSI, we take gonioscopy in depth, so I'm not going to go in detail. But remember that we are, basically want two different patients we have in mind. One angle is occludable, and one, what else is an angle? Both require different examination situation. You must remember that. Otherwise, you'll miss the angle closure. If you just do the full light, or indent directly, then you can miss the angle closure and you will diagnose open angle by mistake. So this thing you must remember. The classification based on symptom, mechanism, what we commonly use based ISGO and modified WGA classification, where we say PACS, PAC and PACG. And I'll go in detail about this. The primary angle closure suspect where the filtering pigmented trabecular meshwork is not visible for 180 degree or more. No synechia, IOP is less than 21, no disc field changes. It is primary angle closure suspect, first stage. Primary angle closure can be divided into appositional angle closure, synechial angle closure, and acute angle closure. The appositional angle closure, where this gonioscopically is same as PACS, but pressures are more, no synechia. Where synechia is that the synechia has developed an angle, even a point synechia is confirmatory of synechial angle closure. IOP can be raised, can be normal. The PACG where the disc will change along with the PAC. Now, before I'm just finishing, so I would just say that imaging, the ASOCT nowadays, has been promoted in lots of confirmatory thing for the PACD, but it is not confirmatory for the angle closure because it cannot diagnose synechia. It can definitely not replace gonioscopy at this point in time, and with very high false positive, it cannot replace or cannot use even as a screening tool. So the natural cause, we had published this when I was in Valor. The 22% of PAC has progressed to PAC over a period of 5 years, 28.5% progressed from PAC to PACG. And this is the progression rate. The average incidence of PAC is approximately 0.7. This is from the Chennai study. So I'll come to the management. The first is primary angle closure suspect. Though we don't do iridotomy as a routine treatment in PACD, the recently ZAP trial showed that conversion to PAC, even in the control arm, they had iridotomy versus control. One eye was iridotomy done, one eye was followed up without iridotomy. And the conversion was 8 versus 4 in 1,000 eyes. So the indicating that the conversion, even in the control eye, is very small. The number needed to treat was more than 50, indicates that all patients of PACS do not require iridotomy. Though certain patients like one-eyed, other-eye having PAC or PACG, as I said, family history is plus minus, but risk family history, special situations like repeated dilatation if patient is retinal pathology or logistic issue, we can perform the iridotomy in this group of PACS patients. Now PAC, iridotomy is must. There are different ways we can do iridotomy. I'm not going to go in detail about that. Iridotomy, after 1 week, we do gonioscopy. We must look whether the angle is opened up or not, how much synechia is there. If the patient doesn't have disc field changes, and if angle is not opened up, we can perform peripheral iridoplasty or gonioplasty. Or in plato iris, we can also start pilocarpine. Or if angle is not opened up, pilocarpine, though pilocarpine 2% causes pupillary meiosis, we must consider that issue also. The lens extraction, I'm going to talk a little later because Eagle has come with lots of interesting data. So I try to keep at the end of my talk, but lens extraction can be considered in selected patient. Now PA, so I'll just give an example. So this patient, IOP is normal. On indentation, the angles open up, there is no synechia. Pressure is normal, no blotchy pigmentation. We can say his PACS, we can follow up. But if the pressure is increased to 26, then his primary angle closure, oppositional closure, he requires iridotomy. On other hand, if the patient is even a point cyanic, yeah, even if the pressures are normal, if high is definitely, but even if pressures are normal, the primary anger closure and would require iridotomy as a mandatory treatment. Now, SLT is one other option, but SLT, there is data about SLT. Arun had done a randomized study in Singapore, and they found that the SLT has very limited role. The IOP reduction was less than PG analog. So SLT only can be considered as selected patient after patent iridotomy. And they published that corneal endothelial loss was more in SLT, which we have to keep in mind. PACS, PACG. Now, that is the most common thing we see. Iridotomy usually we perform. Subsequently, medical management. So, you know, the management is little similar to POAG. We can consider iridoplasty or SLT. And surgical management is the main core of treatment if the damage is moderate or advanced. Now, medical management, is there any different than POAG? So if you look at the studies, various publications, we can say that the prostaglandin effect in anger closure glaucoma is as good as beta blocker, even if the angle is 360 degree close. And considering once a day, prostaglandin can be considered as first line of drug in most of the patient if there is no other side effect and cost is not an issue. If the patient is on pilocarpine for whatever reason, then additive effect of prostaglandin analog is limited, only 1.5 millimeter. So in those situations, we can consider other molecules rather than prostaglandin. So the surgical, we have done iridotomy, we can now consider medical therapy. If the pressures advance damage, if the pressures are too high, we can consider filtering surgery. Now in filtering surgery, we have option of trabeculectomy, combined trabeculectomy with cataract surgery and lens extraction. So the logic is that the size and position of lens plays a major role in pathogenesis of anger closure. We know this is the old data that the thickness of lens increases with the age. The lens moves forward. So the anterior chamber depth decreases, the angle becomes more narrow. So lens extrusion would relieve this, would deepen the anterior chamber, reduce the angle crowding, and can have a better IOP control. So this is a theory. The Eagle trial was done for the PAC and early PACG, but they found that they had IOP, the ocular criteria, the IOP reduction, and they had quality of life criteria. And what they reported, that their result indicate that clear lens extraction should be considered as the initial treatment for PACG and PAC with increased IOP. The IOP reduction was 1.2 millimeter more in the cataract surgery group versus iridotomy. The number of molecules, the glaucoma treatment required were less, and the quality of life was better. But quality of life was better because after cataract surgery, the glass, the most of the patient from hyperopia become emmetrope. So I think that was more of the reason for the improvement in quality of life. If you look that study very carefully, they thus did not meet the criteria. They had decided certain randomized pre-study the criteria that what they want. The results did not meet the minimum difference required. They decided that 1.75 millimeter would be clinically significant IOP reduction. They found only 1.2 millimeter. And if you look the study more carefully, I would like to know three questions. Answer: does it improve the disease control? So if you look the study, at 3 years, nearly 50% of the patient gonioscopy findings are missing. So we don't have any information on gonioscopy, even in iridotomy group, which I would like to know. IOP difference is minimum. The disc field progression, they are not written, it's only 3 years. So to use Eagle as a blanket criteria for cataract surgery in all PAC, all PACG, I would say definitely no. There may be selected patient where would benefit. They also didn't do lens vault, which I would say very important criteria. So the Eagle cannot be used as a blanket rule for the cataract surgery in all PAC or PACG. Other options, we have combined cataract and trabeculectomy. We have goniosynucleosis and glaucoma implant definitely for the refractive glaucoma. These all are the standard guidelines. So I'm not going to go in detail. And cyclodestructive procedure only at the end stage, absolute glaucoma, when there is no vision potential. So I will just say, because I was talking about evidence-based, the meta-analysis done of RCT involving trabeculectomy, cataract, and combined cataract surgery found that the combined cataract and Combined cataract and glaucoma surgery, the IOP reduction was maximum, but that came with the cost of more complication. So you have to remember that when you do a combined cataract glaucoma surgery or trabeculectomy, the complication would be more. You have to expand the patient, but certain time we don't have a choice, we would require. So if the patient has an advanced damage, I would consider trabeculectomy as a first line of treatment rather than cataract surgery. Acute angle closure, I'm just covering. I'm not going to go in detail. It required immediate management in forms of IV mannitol, oral acetazolamide, iridotomy. If the iridotomy is difficult, you can do peripheral iridoplasty and then do iridotomy when the corneal edema reduces. But don't forget the fellow eye. Fellow eye iridotomy is must. Otherwise, the risk of acute angle closure in other eye also is very high. And I have seen patient where the fellow eye was not done iridotomy and patient came with the pressure of 50 to me after 2 years of iridotomy done in one eye.
Arjul, your time is up, please.
Last slide.
Thank you.
So I gonioplasty and pilocarpine, two options we have. So this is the guideline. PACS, observe, PAC, iridotomy, and if the pressures are high, medical management. PACG after iridotomy, they have damage, they would require a long-term follow-up. Of course, a PAC also would require, but that, as I mentioned, medical management, certain patient glaucoma surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajul. So we have finished two talks on the diagnostic criteria, one talk on the disease per se. And now we're coming with the next talk by Dr. Var Venkatesh. Now, this talk is very important because this talk is related to the COVID. And he will tell us, I mean, COVID has changed everybody's life, not only in terms of disease per se, but the way we have been treating the patients, our glaucoma patients also. So over to you, Dr. Venkatesh. He will be talking about glaucoma management during the COVID-19 pandemic. So over to you.
I take this opportunity to thank the scientific committee of All India Ophthalmic Conference for giving me this opportunity to talk in this prestigious symposium. So in the next 10 to 12 minutes, I'll be talking about how we were able to do glaucoma care in the COVID era. It's a challenge for every one of us because it's a kind of complex and unique situation. There were a lot of new normal strategies. We had to minimize the spread of infection. We had to protect both our staff and the patients. And also there were a lot of new guidelines which was coming up and changing every few weeks. And normally this is how a flow of patient is. You know, after registration, basic examination, doctor's appointment, optical, medical, in between any additional investigations had to be done. But because of the limitations, especially patients cannot wait long, no, you cannot do several investigations on the same day. You have to avoid crowding. And also there are a lot of health personnel involved. So we had to reduce the number of people involved. So some of the general guidelines, the use of personal protective equipment was so important. We had to use sometimes a single mask or even a double mask or an N95 mask. And this is one thing which every one of us started using, a nice breath shield, which could kind of protect us from the aerosols from patient care who are so close to us. So generally, we had to reduce. So we had to kind of schedule the appointments to reduce the patient load. And we did a lot of things to maintain social distancing, like marking where they wait for registration. We even removed the central chair here because when the chairs were there, they used to keep a few things in the chair, which also had to be sanitized. So we just removed the central chair so that there was a social distancing in seating. And also we try to avoid any attenders if they are quite young and healthy. If they needed some procedure surgeries, then we attended one attendant for a patient. In the OPD, basically as minimal time as possible. So we had to do a lot of things around it. And wherever we had to come in contact, we had to sanitize their hands, gloved hands. And the EMR usage was also difficult because gloved hands, the entry was also difficult. So we had to come up with ideas of even something like an resident doctor helping us to enter the EMR information during the peak period. So when it came to IOP measurement, now Goldman tonometer was being used with all safety precautions, and it was kind of sanitized after every use. And then you can see this elegant V-shaped thing, which our team developed with a couple of the Johnson buds, which helps you to keep the eye nicely open to do some procedures like a suture removal or a needling or a massaging and things like that. So this was developed in our innovation lab with a 3D printer, and this the buds can be disposed after every use. So the assistant or a nurse need not come and hold the lid, no, in cases where you want to keep the lids open. And there are several other innovations around care we had to do, especially to prevent fogging. And then we also developed a nice lid lamp shield, which was again published in IJO. And also we had a nice fridge, which was converted into UV chamber for decontamination of the N95 mask and respirators. Non-contact, initially to begin with, there were some controversies on aerosol generated, but there was some very good information and evidence which was coming up showing that there is not much aerosols being generated. So now people use routinely non-contact, and we also use here. And the other way, during the period when there was no clarity, we started using the eye care pin, and then we were safely sanitizing and using it we tested that up to 8 to 10 patients, the readings are very reliable. Gonioscopy was again restricted to definitive glaucoma patients who had ocular hypertension suspects, narrow angles, and secondary glaucomas. And we tried to avoid wherever we found the chamber was deep on a slit lamp. And whenever it was used, gonioscopy, we used a bezoloid solution to disinfect, and frequent alcohol usage on these lenses can damage the lens, you know, permanently. So it's good to use the sodium hypochlorite solution, and then you keep it for a few minutes so that it gets sanitized before you use on the next patient. Fundus evaluation is another critical step. So you can see this beautiful 90D holder, which again our team developed, so that you don't have to go very close. And also this holder prevents the fogging of the lens. Many of the time, the breath which escapes from the mask would cause fogging of the lens, and which can obscure the view. So this holder helped us nicely hold it, and then the wraparound thing, which was avoiding the fog to fall on the lens. And wherever possible, no, in suspects and follow-up patients, we did fundus photo and uploaded it to the EMR so that we don't have to see the fundus as a routine. The other issue was, again, Humphrey field testing, and a lot of evidence started coming that there's no significant difference between aerosol count in the bowel of a HFA before and after testing. So after a few months, we started routinely doing HFA. The only thing we did was we taped the mask so that we can reduce the aerosol generation when they are doing the feeds. So again, there's a lot of evidence for it, and taping really helps to reduce it. The other way we were doing fields is using our portable virtual reality-based perimetry, which is called the IVA now. We have tested it, and it is validated to the gold standard HFA, and it's very easy and comfortable to do for the patients. And at the end of the fields, we can also kind of sanitize it using a UV box which you had for it, and then you can switch out the box and you keep it for a few minutes before you use it on the next patient. And fundus photo, again, you can see there's a nice clean wrap here so that you can clean in between each patient in case if they come in contact with the eyepiece and the surrounding areas. This plastic wrap really helps. Prioritizing is very important. I think most of them, most of the institutes try to prioritize. We already have a very good system called E1, E2. E1 are high-risk categories, and E2 are people who need care within a couple of weeks or a month. E1 are something which needs care within a few days. So we have a nice program for it already. We made sure anybody who needs procedures like laser or surgery in an emergency basis, we generated an appointment for them, and we also facilitated them getting an e-pass so that they will not miss the follow-up, and we kept reminding them for care. The surgery was again done depending on the risk and the emergency. High-risk cases were preferred under local anesthesia. All the general guidelines which were followed for cataract was also done. And wherever possible, we were doing procedures like Cyclo G6, which was less invasive, and non-penetrating surgeries were preferred. This is the data just to show what happened during the lockdown period in Aravind Eye Care System. If you see, this is a 5-year data between 2014 to 18, 2019 and 2020 comparing. There was a significant reduction, almost minus 80% of glaucoma surgeries, because people were not able to travel because of travel restrictions. So a lot of planned surgery, you know, especially combined surgeries, cataract and glaucoma together, there was a significant reduction in combined trabeculectomy with cataract surgery. You can see it was minus 87%. So there was a huge backlog which we had to clear in the next few months till the second wave set in. So lens-induced glaucoma is just, we wanted to see how much change between 2019 and 2020. The volume of number of OP is less, but if you see the percentage is almost doubled, which you normally is 0.1, became 0.2. So the significant increase because of the delay in cataract surgery, a lot of people presented with lens-induced glaucomas. So a day at Aravind, we normally saw 13 to 15,000 outpatients, but following the lockdown, the volume significantly reduced to 1,500 patients during the peak lockdown. And following the unlock, we were seeing close to 3,500 to 4,000 patients across the system. And more importantly, we were able to function because of our primary eye care centers, our vision centers. So the eye examination was after the peak lockdown was happening normally. And many of these patients would go to vision centers where they were having teleconsultation and referred. This is just to show you the different phases of lockdown. So when the unlock process happened, the volume in the base hospital was not significantly increasing. It's only 40 to 50%. But the vision centers and the secondary care centers, which were in the smaller towns and rural areas, their volume went to 80, even up to 90% post unlock during the phases between June, July, August, September of 2020. So the vision centers played a significant role. So this is another thing which we did, where we tried to talk to the patient using a Zoom platform just for people who have who had surgery recently, who were not able to follow up. We were just trying to talk to them to see how their condition is. And then we also facilitated if they wanted an appointment to the base hospital. There's always problem with telemedicine, right? When you're doing like this, you need an IOP, you need visual field analysis, you need to visualize the fundus. And that's where we thought, why can't we Uberize eye care? No? Why can't we send a vaccinated trained technician to the home of these patients? So we looked into the data, we fixed appointments with patients who really needed care. And then you can see one of our technician with all the equipment in his backpack going to the house of one of our glaucoma patients, you know, who needed a kind of urgent care. And then the vision was tested using a Peak software. It's a portable eye examination kit, which was used. And then the intraocular pressure was measured. Visual fields was done using a virtual reality perimetry. And then his fundus photo was also taken using a portable fundus camera, the fundus on phone. And then all these images were Wi-Fi transferred to the base hospital, the ophthalmologist in the base hospital. And he was giving the live consultation immediately to these patients. So we found that we piloted this, and we found that there is a future for Uberizing eye care and maybe glaucoma, diabetic retinopathy care, so that the patients who really need the services, even beyond pandemic, we can do this. And we also explored ideas like this. You know, we have to look at ideas like this, which have been published, where intraocular pressure was done on a drive-in, and then new digital modes of care was being explored. So we also have to learn from some of these evidences. So again, I would like to take this opportunity to thank, whenever there is a situation like this, we need to be flexible, we need to be agile, and also, again, resilient and open for new ideas to explore. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Venkatesh, for summing up everything properly. Now we go with the next speaker, Dr. Prateep Vyas. He is going to talk on newer updates in medical and laser treatment in India. Over to you, Dr. Prateep Vyas.
Well, can you see the slides?
Yeah, you're audible and visible, sir.
Okay. Good evening, and thanks Amit and Scientific Committee of AIOS for having given me this opportunity. I would be talking on the newer updates in the medical and the laser treatment. Why we want newer updates in the medical management? So currently we have lot many medication in our armamentarium to treat the glaucoma, But unfortunately, none of the currently available medication is free of systemic and local side effects. Many of these drugs, they do not lower the intraocular pressure throughout 24 hours, particularly the beta blocker and the alpha 2 agonist. Many patients are unable to tolerate one or more of these medications. And even when all four agents are used in combination, then also they are not able to lower the intraocular pressure adequately. So obviously there is a quest for new molecules. So what we are looking for? We are looking for a molecule which has a novel mechanism of action, which almost mimic like the physiological mechanism of regulating the intraocular pressure. And the drug we are looking for should be highly effective both during night and during the daytime, preferably with additional pharmacological properties like what we have been talking theoretically is a neuroprotection and vasoprotection. And obviously, the dosing should be minimal, like the prostaglandin analog once a day. It should be better tolerable and affordable to the patient. Look at this. You know, this lady was on the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor and the PG analog. And you can see that lots of hyperemia. Look at this lady. This was on the PG analog and so much of hyperemia. This young gentleman has used the PG analog for quite a few years and he has developed the prostaglandin-associated periorbitopathy. This gentleman was on the alpha 2 agonist for a couple of years and developed lots of excoriation and skin allergy. So you can look at this photograph and you can see that what problem we have with our current medication in the glaucoma. Look at the history of the glaucoma medication. We have so many medication in our armamentary and history goes way beyond 150 years when the pilocarpine was introduced. Pilocarpine still has its own role to play in the medical management of glaucoma, particularly angle fusel glaucoma. And 50-year-old medication is the beta blocker. It is a timolol maleate, and it remains a gold standard anti-glaucoma drug in India. And the best drug was introduced way back in 1996 was the PG analog, the latanoprost. A couple of years back, it was introduced in the Japan, and that was a unoprostan, but the efficacy of the unoprostan was much less as compared to the latanoprost. Following that, for almost 20-25 years, we developed some medication, but of the same group, not of the different group. Recently, there is some excitement in the medical management of the glaucoma. So basically, we are using the four class, and if you include pilocarpine as well, then we are using the five class of the medication to treat the glaucoma. Most important is the PG analog, where we are using the latanoprost, trevoprost, tefluprost, unoprostan, and bimetoprost. Other is the beta blocker, where the timolol is the most popular. Out of the alpha agonist, the primotidine is the most popular. And for the carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, we are using the torsolamide and the prinzolamide and oral acetazolamide. So look for what we are looking for is for the advances in the medical management. And these advances could be in the form of the new molecules, the new combination, and the new drug delivery system. So the first drug is not a new molecule, but obviously it's a new exciting PG analog, which has a dual mechanism of action. It is like a PG analog, plus it has a property of nitric oxide releasing because of the butanediol mononitrate, which is present in this. So once it penetrates the cornea, it disintegrates into these two components, and it releases the nitric oxide, and Vyzulta is the brand name of the drug, and this prostaglandin analog, this is the latanoprostene, reduces the intraocular pressure similar to the other PG analog. But because of this nitric oxide releasing property, it relaxes the trabecular meshwork. So there is some additional lowering in the intraocular pressure as compared to the other PG analog. Apart from that, because all of us know that the nitric oxide is capable of dilating the blood vessel, so it might be having some neuroprotective property as well. And it is a pretty potent PG analog because of its dual mechanism of action. and it reduces the intraocular pressure by almost 7 to 9 millimeter of mercury from the baseline. The other molecule is a very exciting molecule because obviously it has a separate mechanism of action, and that is the ROCK inhibitor. The molecule is nitarsudil and the riposudil. The nitarsudil was introduced in the USA, and the riposudil was introduced in the Japanese market about a few years before. The nitarsudil is used as a once-a-day dosing, and it has a dual mechanism of action. The dual mechanism of action is through the ROCK and the NET. NET is the norepinephrine transporter. So how it acts, I will explain you in this slide. You just look at this. This is the canal of the Schlemm. This is the trabecular meshwork. And these are the intratrabecular cells. And this is the juxtatrabecular matrix. And this juxtatrabecular matrix has a tight junction of these cells. So what this ROCK inhibitor does, it relaxes the smooth muscles over here. So because of that, this junction gets relaxed and there is a relaxation of the trabecular meshwork. And obviously it does the remodeling of the trabecular cells as well. So because of that, there is more spacing between these cells. So because of that, there is some excessive aggression of the aqueous humor from the trabecular meshwork to the canal of Schlemm. So because of these two mechanisms of action, it has the capability of reducing the intraocular pressure more than what beta blocker reduces the intraocular pressure. That's why it's a non-inferior to the beta blocker. And this schematic diagram shows the two mechanisms of action more clearly. The norepinephrine transporter acts exactly like the beta blocker because, again, it acts through the autonomous nervous system. So it inhibits the production of the aqueous humor. And the ROCK inhibitor enhances the aggression of the aqueous. There might be one more mechanism of action because of the epistleral venous dilatation, because the ROCK inhibitor is a potent vasodilator. So because then if this mechanism of action is there, then it has a triple mechanism of action. Number one, it reduces the aqueous production. Number two, it enhances the aqueous secretion. And number three, it reduces further intraocular pressure by reducing excessive venous pressure, excessive aqueous flow by dilating the epistleral veins. So the brand name of this drug, which is available in the United States of America and was approved by the US FDA in 2018, is the Ropressa. It is by the RA Pharma. And as I said, that it has a dual mechanism of action, at least by inhibiting the NET and by inhibiting the ROCK enzymes. And the reduction in the intraocular pressure is somewhere around 5 to 6 millimeter of mercury. But I will tell you that, you know, in our clinical practice, we do not see that much of reduction in the intraocular pressure. The another drug which I was telling to you is of the same class as the ROCK inhibitor and is available in the Japanese market with the name of Glenate. It was available in Japanese market way back in 2016. And we have used this drug from 2017 to 2019 through some of our patients. But obviously, we were not impressed that much because with this drug. And as you can compare the Glenate and the Ropressa, similar to the Unoprostan and other PG analog, it has a more active drug in it. It is present in a higher concentration, but still the IOP lowering efficacy of riposudil is less than the nitarsudil. And obviously the dosing of this is also twice a day. There are lots of side effects with the ROCK kinase inhibitor. The most important is the hyperemia. It is almost present in almost 30% of our patients. And in some of the patients, it is more than what you get with the PG analog. It causes lots of burning and irritation, at least for a couple of weeks in a patient. And it is very irritating to the patient. The IOP lowering as an add-on and medication is not very exciting, and it goes up to 2 to 4 millimeter of mercury. Obviously, it has some additional properties and it's considered to be a cornea clearing agent, But obviously, there is a big question mark on that, because in some patients, it causes corneal edema as well. That mechanism could be because it may cause the cataract-like changes in some of the patients. So this is one of my patients where you can see that huge vasodilatation after installation of the Ropressa. And here, after putting up the biosimilar molecule, which is available in India, you can see that lots of hyperemia was present after a couple of days of putting the biosimilar molecule. After a couple of months, some of the patients, they develop this kind of corneal verticillata, and even their vision goes down. And once you discontinue the medication, a couple of months later, this corneal verticillata disappears. So the ROCK inhibitors have some advantages. You know, this is a new class of drug, non-inferior to the beta blocker, once a day dosing, and probably it has an additional property like neuroprotection and endothelial protection, but lots of disadvantages like conjunctival hyperemia. And practically, in my opinion, it is inferior to the beta blocker, causes lots of corneal verticillata in lots of patients, and poor tolerability. There is a new combination of drug with the name of Roclatan, which is considered to be the most potent anti-glaucoma drug. It's not yet available in India, but I have used in a couple of patients, and it causes a huge amount of hyperemia because both the ROCK inhibitor and PG analogs both are notorious for causing the conjunctival hyperemia. And there are some sustained release PG analogs. Is out, and similarly, this pimetoclast insert, they are also out because the patient were not able to tolerate. But this new intracameral implant is the Durista from the Allergan. Now, probably it may come in India. It is injected into the anterior chamber and it settled down at 6 o'clock position. It's biodegradable and it has a capability of reducing the intraocular pressure up to almost 6 months following the insertion, and it's available in 10 microgram dosing. That has a 10 microgram of pimetoclast in it. There are some preservative, just I'm concluding, just last slide. So the last is the new lasers. So obviously there is no new laser available. The SLT is almost 20 years old, so there is no point in talking to them. All of us are very familiar. The G6 probe and the micropulse transscleral therapy, which I have started using from 2014. So that is also pretty old. NCPC is also very old. But yes, people keep on talking about the micropulse laser, which is superior to that. But in my experience, I don't consider it superior to the TSCPC because I use particularly in the blind eye, and the TSCPC works very well. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Thank you, sir, for comprehensively covering an update on medical therapy mainly. So finally, before we start the discussion, I think we have one important topic. We have Professor Tanush Dada, who will be talking to us about the current applications and also the future of MIGS. Now, MIGS is there in the Western world for several years now, but in India, I think we are getting prepared. It's going to be like a new wave or even a tsunami soon, because MIGS is meant for any anterior segment surgeon. Any good cataract surgeon, if they start doing MIGS, the market for MIGS and the mild to moderate glaucomas is really going to go up. So, Tanuj?
Yes, I'm just sharing. Somehow the slide is not getting shared. The slide is visible now.
Slide is visible?
Yes, slide is visible. Just 1 second.
You can even close and try again, Tanuj.
No, is it visible now?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Thank you. So thank you for this kind invitation. So I'm going to outline the truths and myths behind the minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. I have no financial disclosures. And firstly, what is something very new in MIGS is a new implant that shunts the aqueous from the anterior chamber to the tear film. And this is completely independent of the episcleral venous pressure. So this is the new implant. It's called the beacon shunt. It's made of polyethylene glycol. And it just put after clear corneal incision, it shunts the aqueous to the tear film. And in addition to lowering intraocular pressure, it also has an effect on the ocular surface as the aqueous is directed onto the tear film. So this is not my video. This is just borrowed from the internet because I found this a very exciting sort of new device, which is independent of the episcleal venous pressure. You just put it in and that's it. And it gradually starts to drain aqueous. And you have aqueous draining onto the tear film. So even the dry eye of the patient benefits. And you can see there's a small stream of aqueous coming directly to the tear film. So that is the recent advance in the MIGS surgery, is the Beacon Aqueous Microshunt. And coming to the traditional MIGS, we have ab externo filtration. The new implant is the pressure flow from Santen. Then you have the ab interno MIGS to enhance trabecular outflow, the various stents, GAT, etc. The supracoroidal implants, which have been withdrawn due to endothelial problems. And we have the subconjunctival filtration with the Zen implant from Allergan, which is also to be marketed in India. The trabecular meshwork procedures basically are three types. Either you cut the trabecular meshwork, you dilate it, or you stent it. So these are the three modalities that are available to us, and I'll be discussing about them. So firstly is the eye stent. This is one of the easiest surgical MIGS procedures and is now one of the most popular glaucoma procedures, mainly done by cataract surgeons. And as you will be aware, this is the smallest stent in the human body, and it is also a very precious metal, as you can see, $1,000 tag for such a small weight. Now the eye stent is designed to improve aqueous outflow. Acts by stenting through the trabecular meshwork, so you have a direct communication between the anterior chamber and the canal of Schlemm. Now, the first version of the implant, what were the results? So most of these studies have taken the IOP of less than 21 as a success criteria. And you can see at 1 year, 68% of eye stent patients had IOP less than 21 as compared to 50% with cataract surgery alone. So the incremental effect of the implant is very less if you compare with cataract surgery. And then you have this new version called the eye stent inject, where now you have preloaded two eye stents. So instead of one, which was not affected, now they are putting two eye stents at the similar surgical setting. And this was the result from one of the most reputed groups from Europe, led by Henry Marmute, the 1 year surgical outcomes of the two eye stent inject devices. And you can see at the end of 1 year, the IOP reduction with two eye stents was 8.7% reduction. And in the control group, that is FACO alone, this was a retrospective control, they reported IOP drop of 15.2%. So only a 8.7 drop with FACO plus two eye stents. And I was asked to comment on this paper for the IGR, and you can see what I have written. This is eye stent inject. This is the least effective of the MIGS procedures. And actually, we should have a expert consensus and ethical discussion between the glaucoma community on the usage of these implants, which are very less effective and so costly. Now, why is it that these implants are not working and they are producing a very variable result? That is because of the anatomy of the outflow channel. So if you see the work done by Alex Huang, the aqueous angiography, the outflow channels are very non-uniform. So if you're putting an eye stent in an area where there is no outflow channel, it's not going to work. And that is why you're getting a poor outcome and a variable result, unless you do an aqueous angiography guided surgery. So the next option is, why not open a wide area of the canal, trabectome, Kahuk dual bed, the Japanese Tahita microhood. And the new one, very interesting, it's called BANG. So bent ab interno needle goniectomy. You just go in with a 25-26 gauge needle and do what you're doing, just rip off the trabecular meshwork. So the initial results of the trabectome surgery from the United States. Again, IOP cutoff taken as less than 21. And you can see the success outcome. 22.4% of trabectome achieved this success rate as compared to 76% of traps. And then you have the Mayo Clinic series on the trabectome, where when they had an IOP cutoff of less than 18, only 22% success rate with trabectome. So actually, they recommended that this surgery is appropriate for patients requiring a target IOP of 21 millimeter or above. So I don't know why this is being recommended for glaucoma patients, because there the target IOP is quite less. Then you have this Japanese very innovative adult trabeculotomy, which you do with micro hooks. And here they are removing the trabecular meshwork in both nasal as well as temporal area by two incisions. So they are removing nearly 180 to 240 degree of the trabecular meshwork. And again, you can see, if you see IOP less than 18, only 32% of eyes achieved IOP less than 18 at 2 years follow-up. And then you have the comparison of the eye stent with the Kahook dual blade. And you can see this is very important to note when you have all authors are receiving financial support for the study. And you can see the IOP drop with the Kahook dual blade ranges from 13 to 24%, very large study to 37 patients across 6 months. So it's a very modest lowering of IOP. So now coming to what is becoming popular in India, that is the GAT, and especially with the suture. So you forget about the outflow channel where they are. You just open 360 degree of the canal of Schlemm. And this is the initial report by Dr. Devinder Grover. And you can see the summary. Definitely, there is an IOP reduction in the range of 30 to 40% with GAT. One third of patients have hyphema, one third fail. The IOP is in the high teens, ranging between 15 to 18. So this can achieve a target IOP in patients with early glaucoma, but not in advanced or moderate glaucoma. And you have a category of non-responders where the patients don't respond to this surgery. And I'll come to why. So if you see the comparison of GAT versus trabeculectomy, you can see TRAP can achieve IOP 11 to 12, and the GAT can achieve IOP ranging from 15 to 16. So what is being recommended is that when a patient of glaucoma comes, you do the GAT first. If it controls the IOP well and good, and if it doesn't work, then you do a TRAP. And this study, even above 18 years, they recommend that you go ahead and do a GAT first. Now, what is the main problem I anticipate in the future with GAT? That is, you are going to get spontaneous hyphemas because you have opened up the entire trabecular meshwork. So if you have a rise in IOP or a rise in the episcleral venous pressure due to any movement or any sort of activity, or patient has an anticoagulant, you can get these late onset hyphemas without any trauma. So this patient, you can see, just with dilatation, he reported hyphema, and this is now being increasingly reported with literature, the late onset hyphema with the GAT procedure. And if you see the post-op now recommended with GAT, you have to leave a large amount of viscoelastic head end elevation. You have to stop anticoagulant for a long time. And you shouldn't do it in a young patient. You have to restrict their physical activities. You have to warn them against any type of Valsalva maneuvers. And imagine patient is now 20 years and you have removed the trabecular meshwork. In the future, you can get drugs that target the trabecular meshwork, and SLT you are ruling out as an option. But again, the serious complication is going to be reflux bleeding anytime you get the intraocular pressure less than the episcleral venous pressure. And if this fails, you are going to do a TRAP, which is going to lead to a low IOP, and then this reflux bleeding can be a serious complication. Now, what is the problem that we are not anticipating is the turn back elevation. With whenever you are operating on the Schlemm's canal, initially it will definitely work. But if you see the success probability on the long term beyond 2 years, there is a fibrosis and healing of the area where you have operated. So you get a poor success if you go beyond 2 years. And that is very important that you have a rebound elevation of intraocular pressure if you see the long-term outcome. And that is the causing the poor success of MIGS. The two main reasons are that you are not targeting the distal outflow. So many of the patients have an obstruction that is beyond the canal of Schlemm. And secondly, the healing response you are getting after 1 to 2 years is obstructing the flow and leading to surgical failure. And that is primarily caused by fusion of the trabecular meshwork leaflets. After GATT, the accumulation of pigment and a membrane covering the canal of Schlemm. And most importantly, with these procedures, you are damaging the outflow channels. And a recent study reported after the abenteral trabeculotomy, if you see the late post-op, 86% of patients in primary open angle coma are developing peripheral anterior synechia. So you are covering an open angle disease into an angle closure disease. And the same effect of a 360 degree trabeculotomy you can get with a very small opening. So the trabeculectomy opening size is not correlating with the IOP reduction. And that is why the results of the Kahoog dual blade are sometimes even better than GATT, although you're opening 360 degree of the trabecular meshwork. And this is very important to understand. In this study, they evaluated the effect of the removal of trabecular meshwork. 1 clock hour, 30%, 4 clock hours, 42% resistance, and 12 clock hours, 49% resistance. So even with 1 clock hour, you get 60% of the effect of 12 clock hours. So I think it is not a wise idea to just rip off the trabecular meshwork which nature has placed for us. And regarding the quality of life, no difference in quality of life between MIGS and trabectomy. And in fact, you need a higher medication.
Dr. Tanush, can you please
trabectomy group? So I think I will conclude here. We have to be cautious with the new MIGS techniques. Ripping off the trabecular meshwork is not an easy way out, and it will have long-term consequences. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tanush. So we now take, we discuss each and every talk by two panelists. So to discuss the first talk, that is update on structure and function in glaucoma diagnosis, I request Dr. G.C. sir and Dr. B. Shanta madam to please discuss the first talk which was presented. Over to you, G.C. sir. You have to unmute yourself, sir.
Sorry. So thanks for the opportunity. It was an excellent comprehensive presentation by Sushma. In the context of structure function correlation, I think the important point to remember is that the functional evaluation is a log scale and the structural evaluation is in a linear scale. That is why there is a discordance between the structure function correlation. The second thing that is coming up in more recent studies is the need for a 10-2 program before you diagnose somebody as having a preperimetric glaucoma. So the central points resolution that is there in the 24-2 program is inadequate to pick up the damage that is occurring in the central field. So 10-2 program is mandatory before we diagnose somebody as a preperimetric glaucoma. There is a beautiful article by Donald Hood where he actually goes into the details of all the earlier studies which looked at the myth that the structural loss precedes the functional loss because we were not testing the function adequately with the 10-2 program. I would recommend that article. Going on to talking about the ability of the structural test to detect the functional test ahead of time, I don't think the last word is yet spoken about that. Because of the functional reserve that a glaucoma patient has and trying to decide the progression earlier and earlier with the functional tests, which are not validated by subsequent progression on the functional test, we might be enhancing the therapy where it may not be required, is my personal concern. So I think as far as progression is concerned, still depending upon the validating the structural changes by a robust functional testing, I think is what is important. So that's my take on the structure function correlation at this point of time.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Shanta ma'am.
I think Dr. GC has said it all. I just have one more point to add. It is important to realize that in our population, we are missing a lot of our moderate advanced glaucomas itself. But now patients are aware and they do come to us earlier, especially if their relatives recommend that they get the earlier evaluation done, a comprehensive evaluation done. So once we see early glaucomas, ocular hypertensives, dissuspect, it would be important to get all the basic investigations done, a dysphotograph, imaging with the OCT and visual field analysis, if you think that the patient might be having functional damage. These three tests would help you in diagnosis and follow-up. So I think that is what is required.
Thank you, ma'am. So coming to the second talk by Dr. Devya Rao, the potential application of AI in glaucoma, the hot topic, AI. So to discuss her talk, I invite Dr. Satyan and Dr. Surinder Pandav. I think Dr. Pandav is not logged in. So I request Dr. Satyan and Dr. Krishnada, sir, to please discuss her talk. Over to you, Dr. Krishnada, sir.
Yes, Amit, thank you. I think that was quite a basic but a very exhaustive and comprehensive talk by Dr. Divya on how much has happened in the AI arena in diagnosis of glaucoma. I think when it comes to automated artificial intelligence or automated algorithms, there are two aspects which we need to remember. One is for the purpose of screening, how far we can detect glaucoma to a larger extent so that we'll be able to bring in a larger component of those with glaucoma in the community under treatment earlier so that progression to blindness can be largely be delayed or avoided. That's one aspect. Another aspect is how do we utilize artificial intelligence algorithms to detect progression in a clinical setting? So as far as these two are concerned, I think the first one to do with the community screening or population screening using algorithms or artificial intelligence devices or techniques are probably not yet very robust, as Dr. Divya appropriately concluded. They are still not yet robust, although of recently lower cost devices like smart phone-based devices like Remedio and all those things are available. I think screening in populations using artificial intelligence is still a far cry, and we need to really wait for some robust technology to come in and popularized. And I think artificial intelligence probably has a much better promise when it comes to detecting progression in the clinical setting is concerned, because all of us know that detecting progression in glaucoma is not very easy. So I think if there are better algorithms are available and field tested to detect progression earlier, I think that would be a great tool in the hands of clinicians to detect progression. I think I have all that to say now, and over to Satya.
thank you, Amit. I just want to say that we can just divide the disease into two categories, or not the disease as such, the clinicians. One where they are unable to really identify the glaucomatous changes. That is where I feel the artificial intelligence, especially on the fundus photograph, that really helps to pick up the diagnosis of glaucomatous changes. That is one area where it is going to be hugely beneficial. Because though we take so many times about the optic nerve head changes in glaucoma, but many people still, they may not be dilating or they may be missing. There are artificial intelligence is going to be really helpful. The second thing is on the progression. Hello?
Yes, Satyan, go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
The second thing is on progression. Obviously, in the clinical settings, like institutions, even if it is not institution, definitely the progression analysis softwares, they use artificial intelligence. And though all of us do know to an extent how to really look at the progression, But looking at the velocity, the visual fields, and the fundus photography, definitely the area of artificial intelligence is going to be there. But one caution on this is that whatever said and done, we need to look at whether the machine is having an issue or not. Because many times, all these are softwares. They may have their own issues, and you may not understand that what issue is going on. So be cautious that it is just not enough that you just look at that and then treat the patient on basis of what the machine says. That's my take home.
Thank you, Dr. Satyan. So coming to the next talk, evidence-based practice for primary angle closure disease, I invite Dr. Ramakrishnan sir and Dr. Chandrima Paul to discuss this particular talk. And before we had a question for this particular talk, I think it is answered. So over to you, Dr. RK sir.
Thank you, Dr. Amit and Evans for the nice opportunity. It's of course, Dr. Rajul has given a comprehensive presentation of angle closure disease, starting from PACS, PAC, and PACG. And here the key point, he mentioned about all these, when to do PA and when to do clear lens extraction and what are the advantages of doing lens extraction and other things like that. The problem with the trabeculectomy and also with the combined surgery. But one of the important key here is the they should be able to do a good gonioscopy. Unless you do a good gonioscopy, most of the time, especially for fellows and other postgraduates, they miss most of the time this all these three categories, PACS and PAC and PACG. So that's why sometimes the number of the unnecessarily we were doing laser radiotomy. So one of the thing what I feel is the proper teaching of gonioscopy to all our fellows, because as he mentioned, the conversion of PACS to PAC in 5 years time and also PACI to PACG is very much less. So unnecessarily we will be treating, of course, in certain situations we have to do PA, like where they need a repeated dilatation, like examination of posterior segment, diabetes, and all these things. But in routine practice, the most of the time, so your careful gonioscopy is very, very mandatory to especially managing this situation. That's what I feel.
Dr. Chandrima, your views? Please unmute yourself, Dr. Chandrima. You are muted. And also, we have a question from the delegates for this particular talk. Now, some experts are recommending micropulse before TRAP in angle closure glaucoma. So what is the evidence-based status and what is the opinion of the whole panel? Micropulse before TRAP in angle closure glaucoma. The opinion of the whole panel.
Okay, so Dr. Rajul's talk was indeed a very well-structured talk and after extensive literature search. So I'd just like to make a couple of points here. A is that the ZAP trial, which was done. The ZAP trial, actually, I would not give very much of weight to the trial because the actual cases after the provocative test, they actually did not take those cases into the study. So that, I think, was rather fallacious because those other cases would actually go into angle closure. So they needed to take those cases in the trial. So the ZAP trial, I would not really go by. And I think laser iridotomy is a relatively safe procedure, and where you think the indications are right, you ought to definitely do a laser iridotomy. And number two is the EAGLE study, which was done. The EAGLE study also, I think, is a hyperrated study about extraction of clear lens, because the IOP reduction that they received after EAGLE study was just about 1 millimeter of mercury, which really does not actually justify doing a cataract surgery or a clear lens extraction, actually. So before you do a clear lens extraction, please look at other options. That would be my message. Thank you.
What about the role of micropulse before TRAP in angle closure glaucoma? The one comment from each panel member.
start with Chandrima. No?
Yeah, so yes. Micropulse.
Yes, Chandrima.
I think some net disturbance. Somebody else can take it till she stabilizes.
Micropulse is still not this, but it.
Amit, can I just add my few points to this?
Yes, Dr. Sipu.
Okay. See, we have been doing since 2018.
Yeah, before, can you hear me? Yeah. Before internet.
I think Shanta wanted to say something.
Yeah, I wouldn't agree that we need to do the...
We couldn't hear that.
Primary angle closure. I don't think we have sufficient evidence yet in the spectrum of angle closure disease that we have, that microdiode would be a better option than trabeclectomy or a cataract extraction or a phacotrabeclectomy. So in time, in our scenario, I don't think we have sufficient evidence that...
Anybody else has any comments?
Amit, can Sachin. I just comment?
Sachin can go ahead. Yeah.
So we have done quite a good number of angle closures. The idea of doing the micropulse in all these angle closure disease is not every patient. Where you have a higher IOP levels, where you have a very shallow chambers, where you expect very high complication rates. So for example, you have a 40 and 50 intraocular pressures. You have given the patient on maximum medical therapy, if it is still not working, say even after IV mannitol, I would definitely do a micropulse. It is very safe. We have a lot of results now. And actually one talk I had an hour ago. So there are a lot of presentations and publications on micropulse in angle closure disease. But definitely it really helps in reducing the complications. But I wouldn't say it is going to be the alternative, complete alternative for doing the trabeclectomy, but reduce the intraocular pressure levels to a safe level. And if you want to take up the future trabeclectomy or just a fact emulsification, then it really helps.
Thank
so I'm talking about from the practical perspective.
Amit, can I just add one?
Yeah.
So, you know, as Satyan said, you know, in a case-based basis is a different issue doing it, you know, what Satyan feels. But I think that when we talk about evidence-based, I don't think we have, so when we say that, you know, we would do before trabeclectomy, we have to have enough evidence that it is safer and better. So because in whatever said and done, it's end, it's a destructive procedure. So
it is not, sorry to disturb you.
And Satyan, it is not as destructive as is. But
Dr. Rajan,
if you have to divide that way, where it would, we would put it. We have to put it under the destructive procedure.
This is a never-ending debate. We'll conclude this talk over here. We'll go to our next talk, glaucoma management during this COVID-19 pandemic. So the Arvind model was talked by Dr. Vaktesh. So I would like to take one quick comment from LV Prasad. Dr. GC sir will talk about his how COVID has changed their management. And we'll take one quick comment from Dr. Shanta as how SN has changed their role in this COVID pandemic.
I think it was an excellent presentation as far as the safety of the staff and the patients are concerned. Whatever measures we have to take, that is what is everybody does. The realization that at the primary and secondary level, the care bounced back to much better levels than a tertiary level is a reality that even we have seen at LV Prasada Institute. The secondary and primary level care probably bounced back much more than the tertiary care because of the difficulty of travel and accessing care. So going forward in the healthcare system, if you have the basic primary secondary level care closer to the doorstep of the population, that's the way to go rather than building huge complexes in cities where patients, even for a minor problem, need to travel. I think that's a reality that we need to understand. And the challenges of COVID have taught us a lot of new lessons and opportunities, like taking care to the doorstep of the patient, even in cities. The home care is what we call, what Venkatesh called it as Uberization, is what we are also getting into. Teleconsultations and home care have helped a lot of patients. I think I'm in complete agreement with what Venkatesh has said. We have learned the same lessons and we also went in the same direction.
Thank you.
Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Shanta.
We followed more or less the same protocols that Dr. Venkatesh had described. I think initially we were all really worried that fomites would make a difference, but I think now we understand that most of the problems are with aerosol generation. So we didn't face transmission in the hospital as much as we expected initially. So all the protocols that were in place really made a difference, and hardly anybody developed the infection from the hospital. Most of our staff developed infection from people at home. The second point is it definitely increased the number of teleconsultations that we had. Though it is difficult to comment about a patient's condition without examining them ourselves, we could just give them some broad guidelines. Most of our decisions had to be made based on their local ophthalmologist's evaluation. So it is a little tricky to give any kind of advice. You can just give some broad guidelines depending on their previous reports, and it would be better to examine the patient ourselves. So with that caveat in place, teleconsultation, there are a lot of plus points in this kind of situation, but without examining the patient ourselves, it would be, we should remember that we have to be a little cautious.
Thank you, ma'am. So coming to the fifth talk, that is newer updates in medical and laser treatment in India. So this was talked by Dr. Pratip Vyas. To discuss this particular talk, I invite Dr. Chandrima and Dr. RK sir. Dr. RK sir, over to you. Newer updates in medical and laser treatment in India.
Yeah, of course, sir. Pradeep has given a very good comprehensive talk, especially the update of the medical management. He mainly touched upon the this RA kinase inhibitors like etasodil and lipasodil. And of course, other molecule also is the heteroprostenide, which is not available in our country. But of course, these RA kinase inhibitors, we are using it for more than a year now. But as we pointed out, you know, there is not much of superiority when compared to other molecule like prostaglandins and other things. And of course, this also we have come across certain side effects, like especially the hyperemia. Most of the patients complained of hyperemia and some sort of discomfort in the eye, some gritty feeling. But they claim that the IOP reduction is almost comparable only. But of course, they claim the triple mode of action for this newer molecule. And one of the other thing they say is more friendly with the endothelium. So that's the one thing with the especially in cases with eye syndromes and throat exfoliation. This can be used much more safer than when compared to other
Dr. Chandrima, over to you.
Yeah, I totally agree with Arkisa that this too much of hyperemia with letarsudil and IOP lowering might be good, but because of the hyperemia, you have to discontinue the drug in most of the patients. And apart from that, it was a very well informative talk. And about the TSPC, well, along with the TSPC, which is in its, as I said, teenage, not infancy, there is also another ultrasound cycloplasty, which we have been doing. And both of them actually need more papers and more trials before we can actually go forward and do it in other cases, apart from refractory glaucomas. Refractory glaucomas, we are doing them with substantial amount of success. But I think we need to do much more larger trials to be able to do them in patients who actually have good visual potential.
Thank you, Dr. Chandrima. So coming to the last talk, I'm going to invite our moderator, Dr. Venkatesh, also for this particular talk, because we had something in our mind because of which we gave this talk. The talk was current application and future of MIGS in India. So Dr. Venkatesh has been doing a lot of MIGS procedures in Aravind Pondicherry. So I take a comment from Dr. Venkatesh and also from Dr. GC sir regarding the current application and future of MIGS in India.
Okay. To begin with, I think Tanuj made it very interesting because the MIGS are very important in any surgical procedure, because we are looking at something which is going to give long-term good results. So we all understand that, you know, some of these MIGs have come and gone, you know, like CyPass has come and gone so soon. Whereas we have this gold standard trabeculectomy and even now tubes and surgeries, which are there because we have seen those patients over years. You know, we understand how the patients behave and how the results are, the evidence. But here the evidence is very small or even very short. So I'm sure I agree with him that we have to look at long-term evidence, but we cannot brush aside. No, we have to keep working on that area also and look at long-term evidences in our eyes. No, they may do better. There may be lesser bleeding or they may be doing better in sine K. We don't know how they behave because many of these regional differences do happen and we'll have to see and then we can come to some kind of a judgment. But it's good to explore some of these because these are things which are going to make a difference because we are buying time at the same time you are preserving your conjunctiva for future surgery. So this doesn't work. You can definitely do a trabeculectomy and offer the best results to our patients. So I think it's a time to explore. At the same time, some of the myths which Tanuj said, I think we should keep that in mind. We have to look at those evidences like those high FEMAs and sine Ks, but that should not stop us from exploring.
Thank you, Dr. Venkatesh. Over to you, GC, sir. Your concluding remark for this particular talk. Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
So I think it's an interesting discussion and probably throws the limitation of the reality that how much of we practice is not actually evidence-based. And when we look for evidence also, we look for evidence that favors our hypothesis. So on a friendly note, emotionally, Venkatesh is in favor of mix and emotionally, Tanuj Dada is in against mix. So the kind of thought process they go through is that kind of a thing. So we need to realize that our emotions and our prior biases actually play into how we use evidence. At this point of time, I would probably agree with both of them that this is a very careful path that we need to tread and we need to evaluate and carefully monitor whatever we are doing. The amount of complications like the high FEMAs that Tanuj Dada talked about, I was not aware of. I think that's a very, very important thing. But is that how common is it? And how do we manage those things? Or is it a permanent problem that the patients tend to have? What percentage of patients have that? Is, I think, what we need to see. Just to extrapolate that to the netarsodil that we are talking about. It may be once a day dosage. It may be reducing the IOP. But if 30% of patients cannot use it, and we keep talking about compliance being an important factor, we cannot just go about doing whatever is the latest without worrying about what is the long-term implication for the patient. I think we need to keep all these things in perspective and realize that we still are not there as far as evidence-based medicine is concerned with the mix. We need to be careful about what we do. There is definitely a potential, but to realize the potential in the process, we probably put some patients through the risk of those surgeries, which is what is inevitable in advance of science.
Thank you, sir. There's a question from the delegate. This is for you, Dr. Venkatesh. Where do you get the 90-day lens holder, nice innovation to prevent fogging? To the hall in charge, this is the last question and then we are going to conclude. Please don't ring the buzzer.
It's actually 3D printed at home, but we can always share the file to whoever is asking. You can send me a WhatsApp. But the other thing which our team did was just use a Dettol cap and that worked really fine. But you don't have a holder for it. You use a Dettol cap to fix your 90D lens and it works really good in preventing the fogging. Basically, you keep a shield around the lens so that the air falls on the shield and it doesn't fog your lens. Because fogging has been a major issue in glaucoma specialists when they're looking at disc and macula. It fogs and then you have a very hazy view. So this really helps. Just try a Dettol cap.
So this was the question by Dr. Shailesh.
Yeah, sir.
Please send the file to me. We'll get 3D printed in our institute.
Definitely, sir. Definitely, sir.
So even this...
both the files, sir. Eye opener and this one.
Sure, please.
So yeah, these 90D things are available with Vogue. It is not cheap though. They are selling it, I think, for 4,500 or 5,000. The anti-fogging device. It is just a plastic sheet, like what Dr. Venkatesh was telling, a cap, and then you can put the 90D inside. So Vogue has come out something like that. You just put a 90D inside. It will prevent fogging. It will keep the 90D at a distance, fixed distance from the orbital rim. But then again, there is a cost. They're charging 4,500 or 5,000 rupees for that particular instrument. And this innovation for Dr. Venkatesh is costing a few rupees.
Not that less expensive. You'll have to get it at least printed. 100, 150 rupees they charge. Yeah.
So thank you, but all the panelists. Yes, sir. You say something.
No. Detal cap is to you can, before throwing your Detal bottle, think of that. The one which you press, no? You remove the pressure and then you use the cap alone to use 90 days. It works.
Okay. So thanks a lot, the esteemed panelists, all esteemed speakers. It was a well-conducted symposium. Since it was the last session, we overshoot it by 10 minutes. But I hope I'm getting a lot of feedbacks here, or even on the WhatsApp. We are attending, we are listening. Very good discussion, very good talks. So this is what keeps us motivating. I thank from the bottom of my heart, on behalf of my chairman, Scientific Committee, Dr. Partha Biswas, and my whole team of Scientific Committee, and my moderator, Dr. Venkatesh, and Dr. Krishnadas sir, and Dr. Satyan, who helped me to develop this particular national symposium. It was a combined decision of all four of us. We decided that we go in this way. And thank you for all the guidance. Thank you, chairperson, speakers, for making this program a great success. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. And sir, at the last, I would like to grab this opportunity, first of all, to thank Dr. Amit Porwal here and also all the speakers. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing the screen time here. Thank you.
Thank you.